Where were we? Sod HaTzelim. Okay, so we started talking about the Tzelem being the intellectual soul. And we said, something interesting about it. That, first of all, it's an intermediate between the divine soul and the animal soul.
Where is it?
And we said, the hint about it is, Yemei Shnotenu Behem Shivim Shana, that every day is another Tzelem. Every day that you have in the world, you receive another Tzelem, another part of the intellectual soul. And the reason that we're given this intellectual soul is because there's no other way for the divine soul to connect with the animal soul. There needs to be something in between. And then we said that וזהו ימי שנותנו בהם 70 שנה דקאי למעלה שאתה ונותנו לנגדך לומנו נמור פניך. That the whole purpose of adulthood is to rectify the early years. Okay. The years when we weren't so aware of what we were doing. היינו שיתפכו בחינת אבונותינו שיהיה לנגדך. So that the sins will be transformed. ועלומנו יבוא למאור פניך. And that our youth will become the countenance of Hashem. Just 6-7 lines down. And all this is done v'hu al yaday atzelim. So each one of these days, it's sort of like it's the importance of having a clear picture of what you need to do in life. That's one way of looking at the tzelim. It's like saying that the divine soul is too detached from this world. It's not. It can't fully be in this world if it doesn't have some kind of intermediate to hold it, to connect it to the animal soul. And the intermediate is the mind, is what we call being conscious. And so, and the consciousness has to be as clear as possible. That's what the idea with the Tzelem is. That it has to be clear about what the purpose of life is, and then it can transform even the things that were done incorrectly into positive things. And it can shine the youth back into our source, back into Hashem. That's why every person was given 70 years. And these 70 years are meant to be used to rectify the animal soul, to use it in the right way. Gam ita be'etz chaim, we said, she'ata ma mevarer ban. That the order now is that the name ma, the 45, yud, hey, aleph, vav, aleph, vav, hey, aleph, which is the name of za, mevarer ban.
Where did you get these numbers from? I don't follow that.
Yud, vav, dalet is 20. And I filled the yud. Good. Dalet. It's 20.
Okay, but what's that going
to be? Hey, Aleph.
Where is that ma?
So, we have to finish the whole name. Hey, Aleph is 6. Vav, Aleph, Vav is 13. So that's 39 together. Hey, Aleph, at the end, another 6, that's 45. So that's Yud, Kei, Vav, Kei, that's equal to 45. The Yud, Kei, Vav, Kei, that's equal to 52 is Yud, Vav, Dalet, that's again 20. Hey, Hey. It's 10. Vav Vav is 12. Another Hey Hey is another 10. So altogether we have 52. Okay? And they stand for the various aspects of how Hashem is revealed in the world. So one of them is Za or Tiferet. So that's Ma, Shema. That's Adam, Ketiferet Adam Lashevet Bait. That Tiferet goes together with being a person. Koachma, because there's a strong relationship between Chochma and Tiferet, because it's like the Abba and the son, Abba Av Veben, Chochma is Abba, Pertzuf Abba, and Tiferet is called Zah, he's like the Pertzuf of the sun. So they have a strong relationship. It's called Mashmo Umashim Bno. They both are called Ma. That's how the Zohar teaches it. So the two of them, they're the Ma. And then the other two really are Sag and Ban. The Bina is Sag. Okay. The Rizal gives a allusion to it. It says that Bina is always hearing. It's Shmia. Like Rashbi is Shimon. So he's Bina. Moshe Zachal Bina. He's the Bina aspect of Moshe Rabbeinu. And what do you hear? What do you hear with your ear? How do you write ear in Hebrew? So he writes it in full there. Usually write it Aleph Zayin Nun. But he writes it Aleph Vav Zayin Nun. So Aleph Vav Zayin Nun is Samech Gimel. But with a kolel. So that's the hint.
A
kolel. He doesn't have a whole kolel of the people learning for him. He just says that Ozen, if I write it out, if I Aleph Vav Zayin Nun is equal to just Zayin. Just Vav Zayin Nun is already 63. So what's the extra Aleph? So the extra Aleph is because there's a kolel, like there's another something that unites everything together.
Oh, okay. So
in modern terms, people would say you're fudging it.
Right.
Okay. It's like you're in a lab, and the data doesn't come out exactly like you wanted it, or it was supposed to. So you fudge a little. So that's not exactly what he's doing, but for modern people, it's very hard to understand where these kolelim come from. It's very difficult. So sometimes you can find somebody who gives a good drush or whatever, but in general, the truth is it's better not to mention them. But it's written in the Etz Chaim that way. So Sag is Bina, and Ban is Malchus. Okay, so it's Ab Sag Ma Ban. Those are the four major fillings of Hashem's name. Tov. In any case, Ma Mevarer Ban. Today, it's the Zah, Tiferet, that is fixing, rectifying Ban, the animal. And Ban equals Behema. That is, as a matter of the same Gematria, 52. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
But in the future, he says, but when you finish fixing the animal, it rises to a higher state. So the ban, which is the malchus, it's like the eshet chayil, it'll become a crown for the one who rectified it. So where does it go? So it leaps over mine, it goes to sag. So it goes to bina. Eshet chai lateret ba'ala, that she becomes higher than him. So she goes up to sag. Why sag? So he says here, why? Ki ashvira b'b'chinat sag. Kulo sag yachdav. Because everything, the whole purpose of life now is to rectify the ban, to rectify the animal soul, because the animal soul represents the result of the shvira, of the shattering of the vessels. Everything the person goes through, and the Arizal's picture, in the Arizal's world, it's very connected to worlds. So he says everything that you go through is in order to collect the sparks that fell into the world in different places. In Chassidus, we're no longer talking so much about the worlds. We're talking more about the neshama. So in terms of the neshama, it's that all the tests that you have, they are in order to collect what belongs to your soul. Not so much to redeem sparks, but rather to even redeem yourself. By redeeming yourself. So what happens when you finish redeeming yourself, he says, that what was broken, that's why everybody feels broken in this world. No matter what you do, everybody feels broken. Why? Because this world is where the shattering happened. So it used to be that the world was broken. In the time there, Arizal was more that the world was broken. But since the time of the Baal Shem Tov, the problem is with the people themselves, that they feel that they're broken. So they have to fix them. But when they fix it, so then they go up to Bina. They receive a new level of understanding, a new level of being, call it aware of the divine in reality. So that's sag. V'hainu b'p'chinat ban shebasag. And so ban goes up to sag. Really what it means is that there's in each one of these of ab sag ma ban, each one of them has an ab sag ma ban in it to make things obviously complex, because the world's a complex place, so it can't be that would be too simple. So in sag we have ab of sag, and we have sag of sag, and then we have ma ban of sag. So this needs to be understood why he says it's the ban of sag. What's the ma ban of sag? So the sag itself goes from the top of the eyebrows, like he says in the person, down to here, to the throat or here. So what's the ban, the lowest part of this? The mouth. That's the malchus. That, first of all, that's where it comes from. The malchus is koach hadibur. The malchus in general is speech. It comes from the ban desag. So it means that the speech will be rectified. Okay, that's what it is. And uviur ha'inyan. V'latid levokshit v'ayor shem sagit aveno sag shebasag. And sag shebasag is already a higher level. Where's the sag shebasag? So the ma'avan shebasag is this part. Both of them together. The sag shebasag is the nose. And the ab shebasag is the eyes and the ears together.
Okay, Baruch Hashem, you managed
to confuse me. So it's just how he describes it. Mm-hmm. So you don't understand it physically. You just say this is a metaphor. So what's the sag of sag? It would be the ears, like we said before. It will be being able to hear Hashem, meaning that the speech will be so rectified. Something crawling on the... Is it big?
Mm-hmm.
How big? It's not big. It doesn't have a tail. It's the one we threw out last week.
Yeah?
I think so. It doesn't have a tail, so it's probably the same one. Anyway.
Because you're my wife, you said.
What's this all good for? Why is this all good for? Because... The whole point is that in the future you'll hear Hashem speaking. You'll be able to hear all the time Hashem speaking. It won't just be that I have to guess from reality what am I supposed to do. Mamash, you'll hear it. Like when the time of Beis HaMikdash.
When did they hear Hashem speaking in the Beis HaMikdash?
When they went to the Beis HaMikdash for Simchat Bet HaShoeva, that was the main time. But you could also hear it on Pesach. I guess during the time they brought the korban, not so clear, but it was also during Pesach. And every half year, a person would hear what he was supposed to do. So it's called the bat kor. It's like Ruach HaKodesh. It's like a yechidus with Hashem. It's hearing, like, what do I need to do? It was very clear to them what they needed to do in life.
They actually heard it or felt it?
No, they heard it. It's a bat kor. It's like hearing a voice. I haven't ever heard it, but at least that's how Chazal described it, that it was heard.
Uviu ra'inyanu, ki b'chinat ma'am varer, hu ha'or ha'nimshach b'b'chinat kli, hu k'mo Moshe, v'nachnu ma, b'chinat bitul b'tachlit. Ve'af al pichon haya b'guf, ve'af shu m'b'chinat abba, haynu rak m'b'chinat ochoraim, kapat kasa gimatria Moshe, ve'ma shkatub mize al pasuk, ani ishnag abay kol dodi dofek, וכן עובלות חוכמה של המעל התורה, פירוש הנמשך בבחינת מוכין דאבה למילותיו, שהיא התורה כאשר ופסול, and so on. כמו כן, בחינת משה היה לו אהבה ויראה ומידות, רק שהיו נמשכים בבחינת מוכין, פירוש שהיה אהבה ויראה שלו בבחינת ביטול בתכלית, בבחינת אבא, מבחינת אחוריים. So there's a lot of Kabbalah here, I'll explain shortly. כי פנימיות האבא הוא פנימיות עתיק, so it couldn't have been from פנימיות האבא, it's just from the מויכין. ולא מבחינת התלהבות שמבחינת אימא, כמו ההפרש בין שבת ליום טוב, שיום טוב מבחינת שמחה, ושבת מבחינת עונג, נהדר בקודש, קודש מילה בגרמי וכולי, כמו שכתוב פרשת אמור. וכן היה אהבה אווירה של משה, וביקש הרי נינה את כבודך פרוש, יראה אינסוף שלא בבחינת כלי. וישיבו כי לא יראני אדם וחי,
וחייהן אינם רואים, אבל במיטתן רואים. Okay. So what does he want to say to us? Say that the ma that's constantly rectifying the animal soul, what is that? That's the power of bittul. You said yourself, that's koach ma. The chokhmah is koach ma. And Moshe himself, we see that he has ma in his name. There's just a shin there in the middle. What's the shin? The shin is the avos. The avos were not batel to Hashem. Why weren't they batel to Hashem? Because they didn't receive mitzvos yet. You can't be batel to Hashem. You can't be completely nullified until he tells you what he wants you to do. And the avos had to work from themselves. They understood from themselves what they needed to do. Just one, Ken, but it wasn't the totality of his whole life. So in one area, he had bittul, and his children also had some bittul. But that's not the essence of their life. Their essence of their life is v'anochi afar ve'efil. What we call shiflus. They had lowliness. What does it mean, lowliness? That they were always walking before Hashem, saying, I'm not worthy of walking before Hashem. That's what made it possible for them to walk before Hashem, because they always felt they weren't worthy of it. Other people were more worthy than they are. But that's shiflus, that's not bittul. Bittul is when Hashem tells you what he wants from you. And that only Moshe Rabbeinu received. So in that sense, Moshe Rabbeinu takes the shin, which represents the three avos, and he adds to it the ma around it. The koach ma, v'nachnu ma, the power of bittul. And because he had this power of bittul, that's why he received the mitzvos. If he wouldn't have had this power of bittul, Hashem couldn't, it's almost, it's like one begets the other, but they're like, it's hard to tell who exactly started the whole thing. Was it that Hashem told Moshe Rabbeinu what to do, and he became bittul to it, and therefore he gave him mitzvos, or was he bittul to Hashem beforehand? Or did he give him mitzvos and then he became batal to Hashem?
But if he didn't get any mitzvos, how could he be batal to Hashem? Okay.
So how could he be batal to Hashem before? No. So that's where the question, how can you be batal without there being mitzvos? Apparently yes, because he says v'nachnu ma before he received the mitzvos.
But he said the others couldn't be batal to Hashem.
Nachon? So it's a big question. Is it something essential in him that has bittul? Or is it, in any case, just to explain the difference, Avram, Yitzchak, and Yaakov, they're chesed, gvura, and tiferes. They're not chokhmah. Meaning that they're serving Hashem from their emotions. That their emotions are telling them, but emotions are very being, they're very ego-oriented, if you want. And you feel them, you understand them. Bittul, selflessness, and chokhmah, and wisdom, that's going out of yourself. It's not feeling anything. That's why he's saying here that the ahava and yira that Moshe Rabbeinu had, it didn't come from his heart. It came from his mind. His bittul created love and fear of Hashem, because Moshe Rabbeinu's love and fear of Hashem is not like Avram and Yitzchak's. Avram and Yitzchak's are natural feelings that they had, like regular feelings that a person has. But they elevated them so high that they became divine in their character. Moshe Rabbeinu, he created feelings. He didn't have them. The feelings were a tolada. They were born from his meditation, from his hisbonus. That's basically what he's saying here. So when we have bittul, when we take the power of ma to rectify the animal soul, we can't use the avos. Because the avos are all part of the animal soul. Meaning you can't rectify it from inside of itself. What do we get from the avos? That even if we don't do things because we understand them, it's still called avodas Hashem. That's the inheritance we received from Avram, Yitzchak, and Yaakov.
Where does Aaron fit into that?
Aaron's with Moshe. We'll see in a moment. But he says, when he says v'nachnu ma, he says we are nothing.
Right.
He and Aaron together. Moshe and Aaron in outside of the Chumash are one person. They're not two different people. In the Chumash and the Pshat, yes, they're two different people. They're two brothers. Mm-hmm. But in when you think about them in an essentialist way, they're just two sides of the same coin. So, but that's the important thing here. He's saying, what is rectification in this world entail? It entails having nullification before Hashem, doing Hashem's will. That's why we do it through mitzvahs. Because every mitzvah that a person does, it represents his willingness to nullify his will to Hashem's will. That's the greatness of what the mitzvah does. Okay? And, like he says in the Tanya, from that, from just meditating on the fact that Hashem has commanded me, from that I can awaken two other mitzvahs called Ava and Yira, love and fear of God, which are, in our case, are mitzvahs. By Avraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov, they weren't mitzvahs. They were their natural inclinations. They loved and feared Hashem just because that's how their psyche was. That's who they were. We are like Moshe Rabbeinu. That if we love and fear God, it doesn't come naturally. What did we get from the patriarchs, from Avraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov? We got that even if we do a mitzvah and we're not able to use the meditation on the mitzvah to awaken love and fear, we can't. We simply can't. We just don't have enough energy, enough feelings. So even if we do it without love and fear, and the mitzvah without love and fear doesn't rise, it's like a bird that needs two wings, left and right wing, which are love and fear. So from the patriarchs, we take what's called the natural love and fear, that every Jew has in him a natural love and fear of Hashem. But again, this is natural. It's not the type that Moshe Rabbeinu wanted. It's not the type that the Torah teaches. But it has its pluses. The plus is that you did a mitzvah, and even though you never felt anything while you were doing it, you can rest assured that this mitzvah rose to where it needed to rise.
Based on what?
That you're a son of Avraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov. That's what he calls Ahava Mesuteret. That's what the Tanya calls the concealed love.
Yeah, but there's this thing called Machshav Azoros.
You can mix it up with all kinds of stuff. That stuff will be mixed up in the Tzelem. That's exactly what's going to happen. That if you have all kinds of Machshavot Zorot, all kinds of improper thoughts while you're davening or whatever else. Davening is always on the cusp of being a mitzvah d'oraisa or a mitzvah d'rabbanan, so it's not a good example. But let's say the person's, learning. It's certainly d'oraita, and he's learning and he has all kinds of other thoughts also. So it didn't awaken anything in him, because for to be able to awaken something, he needs to have a clear mind. His tselem, if you want, has to be, his image of divine being in him has to be completely clean. So since it's not, it doesn't awaken love and fear in him. So says the Tanya, nonetheless, even though he didn't experience love and fear because he wasn't able to awaken them, we still rely on the fact that Avram, Yitzchak, and Yaakov gave us an inheritance, all of us, particularly Avram, to have love and fear of Hashem innately, even if we don't feel it. Meaning that a Jew always, even if it seems like he's doing it completely by rote, there's some level of emotion in it. And it's not empty. It's never entirely empty. That's the main argument of the first half of the Tanya. Not just the first half. He repeats it again and again. Okay. Now he says, the Moshe Rabbeinu asked Hashem, show me your honor, show me your splendor, whatever you want to call it, kvodecha. Perush yireh en sof shelo bebchinat kli. He wanted to see the infinite light of Hashem without it being contained in a vessel. And Hashem answered, ki lo irani adam v'chai, that a person cannot see me and live. But now he says, it's not exactly, you can also read it, ki lo irani adam v'chai, meaning that when you're alive, you can't see me. Aval, b'chayen roim, aval b'mitotan roim. But once the neshama passes away, once the person passes away, he can see. Uchadeita b'midrash tov, in the midrash, shocher tov, on Tehillim. So he has there, uchadeita b'midrash, my mistake, it's not shocher tov, it's just a midrash, I guess it's midrash rabba. Tov ze malach chayim, meod ze malach hamavet. When the Torah says that Hashem on the sixth day he looked at all that he had created and he said it was very good, so good was life, and very was the opposite of life. How could that be? Meod ze malach hamavet, the angel of the opposite of life. Haynu shelachar mita yachol leasig b'chinat me'od. Meaning that after a person departs from this world, so the soul can once again see that which is beyond, that which is not limited. This world, everything is limited. Everything in our lives is limited. There's a finite amount of years you'll live, there's a finite amount of food you'll eat, the finite amount of money you'll make. Everything is finite. There's no way to reveal infinity on a permanent basis. Everything is always finite. So because it's finite, so you can't understand the me'od. You can't understand that which is beyond the finite. Why is it called the angel of death then? So he says here very simply, because you can see it after you pass away. What is it? What is that? So the Malbim has a long passage on this in Yeshaya. I think we talked about it last time. He mentioned something about it. And he says, very simply, there's no evil in the world. Evil doesn't come from above. What is evil? Evil is the experience of limitation. We call that evil. That's what we call. But Hashem, on the contrary, the whole point of this world is to experience the limits. But every time that you break through a limit, if you're able to break through a limit, what's beyond? The infinite. So you experience the good. So in that sense, Lo Yiran Rabbeinu wanted to see it as if he didn't have a body, as if he could experience it without any limits, to experience the unlimited. And Hashem said to him, you can't. The only way you can experience this in this world is to have a vessel. So, and where do you feel it? Let's say you push through something. If a person has a limit on what he's capable of doing, and he pushes through it, so then, like the experience of going beyond. But for that, you need to have a body. You have to feel limits. You have to understand limits. And when you cross the limit, you're able to break through it, then you have what's called an out-of-body experience.
Ooh, wow.
Good. That's what it is. And then you hear. And then he says, then you hear. Meaning the whole rectification here, no pun intended, the rectification is meant to break through the barriers, the limits of the animal soul. And if you can break through the barriers and limits, then you receive an incredible experience which is beyond anything. And by the way, this is also, Rabbi Isaac also explains that this is the source of divine healing. He says, when did we experience divine healing? When we were given the Torah. Says everybody's blemishes, whatever they had, whatever was wrong with their body, was healed. This is why. Because Hashem appeared in his infinite form. And the whole problem with the body, that it deteriorates, that it's sick, that it's not working well, and so on, is because of limits. If you're able to experience that which is beyond the limit, that's exactly the power of healing, divine healing. And it says in that type of healing, it's even stronger than the usual type of healing. The usual type of healing is trying to bring the limits back into balance, trying to make it work again, but all within limited. You cut and you do, or you give this element and that element, and you try to balance it somehow. But when Hashem shows that which is beyond, even he says even a damaged body can work just as well. There's no difference. Because the point is that you're achieving what's beyond the limit. So that moment of being able to go beyond the limit, which is what he's describing here, that is the moment of hearing or feeling the divine infinity. Why? You get to it all the time.
I need to show me about the call.
You came here tonight, right? Mm-hmm. You weren't planning on coming. But then you broke through the limits. Yeah. So it's not the, you know, the biggest limit in the world, but it was a limit.
Yeah. Kleiner
kind. That's what?
That's kleiner kind.
So it's kleiner kind, but it adds up. It adds up. That's the whole point of life. And every time the animal soul imposes me with limits, and the divine soul, it wants to break through that limit. That's what Moshe Rabbeinu does. That's the Moshe Rabbeinu in each of us. That he helps us break through those limits. And every time that you break through that limit, that's called Bechol Me'odecha. That's called going beyond what you are capable of. So today they call it going out of your comfort zone. But it's much more than just comfort zone. It's going beyond what you think you can even do. I thought I could do this. The Rebbe was very big with tzedakah, telling people that that's the main way that you can break beyond your limits. And it's not even that difficult. It's a little difficult in your head, but in practice, it's not even that difficult. And he gives more than what he thinks he can give. I didn't think I can give that much, and he doesn't. What's the greatest example then in the Tanya? He says that if a person is so ill, so he's allowed to spend all the money that he has on his health. Okay? So if he wants to rectify his soul, all the more so. He can give as much tzedakah as he wants.
Yafe. Yala. Very nice man.
What?
It is indeed a very nice man.
Okay. So we'll continue on Thursday, God willing.
Yeah, but it's about Hashem's word.